So welcome back. So now we're going to talk about temperature sensor types. So we have thermocouples, thermopiles, thermistors, RTDs, all these types of different variations of sensors that can convert temperature into ultimately voltage. Now, if you notice, I show a couple things on here, like a thermocouple is a direct conversion from temperature to voltage. Same with a thermopile. It's a whole bunch of thermocouples put together. Now, a thermistor, RTDs, and solid state PN junctions, those all convert temperature to a change in resistance. So that goes back to our earlier discussion on resistance sensors. Then we have to convert that resistance to a change in voltage using one of the previous circuits that we've talked about how you would convert that to a voltage. A different type completely altogether is radiation thermometry, where you get temperature, really infrared waves, that gives us an EMR, or an electric signal that we convert and scale to a voltage. So let's take a look at some of these. So when we have a thermal transducer, we want something that changes with temperature. That's basically what we're looking at. We have a digitally linearized compensation because most of these systems, when we are trying to measure temperature, they're not linear. They're a very nonlinear process. Case in point, a thermocouple uses the Seebeck effect, which is very, very cool effect. It's basically if we put two different types of metals together, and we combine them together at T1 at one point, then we split them off and have common connecting leads off of them, we'll get a reference temperature that we have to have. Now, it used to be that we used a reference temperature typically like freezing water or ice water, where you have kind of a 0 degree, and that was a common reference. These days, you can do a reference where it's actually a chip, where it acts as a reference electronically so that you can get the relative difference. And then you can measure the voltage up. Because you have these two metals, you're going to get this delta V. And as the temperature changes on the left end of the thermocouple, that voltage will change with that temperature. Now, if you notice, the equation is fairly complicated. It's a nonlinear function of temperature. So your EMF, your voltage out, the rough voltage is different constants. So constants A, B, C, and actually goes up to like 7 different constants. And if you notice, there are things that look like you can make a derivative. So you have multiple terms. You have the first term, A times T, second term where you have a square term. Now you have a quadratic. Then you have a t to the 3, so now you have, again, more nonlinearity, so it's a polynomial. And oftentimes, what a lot of the sensors will show is what we call the alpha value, which is really, you're just taking the derivative of the whole thing with respect to t, and so you get the change of energy that you'll get with the change in temperature. And so that's a little bit more simplified. So you can simplify it to the first two terms to get kind of a linear approximation, but you're really missing the boat on all the other terms, right? Because you'll have A plus B times T, but then you would still have C times T cubed and so on. So what they often do is they actually have tables of these constants, or if you have certain sensor types, they will list the constants that you put in, which we can put in software so we can actually get an accurate calculation. Which is oftentimes what we do these days. The beautiful thing about what you might learn when we use LabVIEW is they actually have a lot of the tables for the different types of thermocouple designs that are out there so that you have some standard numbers on how to compensate your voltages. So again, this is kind of like looking a little bit at a thermocouple. So you have something where you're measuring temperature. The cold junction, now is something where instead being at a cold junction, it can actually be a chip. So, and that's where we have something like the LT1025 chip to be able to compensate for that junction. And then we can set it into an amplifier and amplify the signal to get a voltage out. So that's a basic idea of what a thermocouple circuit looks like. And that would go for thermopiles too. Thermopiles, again, are multiple thermocouples. Thermistors are different. This is where there's a change in resistance with a change in temperature. It's a very different bird altogether. First order approximation is that we have a change in resistance that's related to a first order temperature coefficient of resistance K times the delta T, the change in temperature. And these can go in two ways. It can actually go to where there can be an increase of resistance with an increase of temperature. That would be a positive K, and that would be a PTC, or a positive temperature coefficient. Or you can have the opposite, where the resistance goes down as the temperature changes, or as the temperature increases. And in this case, K would be negative, and this is called a negative temperature coefficient, or an NTC type. So you can do either one of those types. It really doesn't matter which one you use, because typically when you bring it into a software anyway, you can always flip the signal if you want it to be look like it's going up when it's going up, when relatively it's going down. You just take the negative. So a thermistor measurement is a little bit different. Again, it's like a change in resistance. So you apply a bias current across the system. If you want to do that with some VCC or some voltage that's applied. Or you can apply a bias voltage with a bias resistor, a fixed resistance, which will generate a specific current across the thermistor, and then you sense the voltage out. Either one of these ways works. It's just whatever is easier for the application of what you're looking for. So these are just kind of the variations. Now, there's lots of conversion methods, and I actually have the link here on All About Circuits if you want to really dive into these different conversions. There's lots of different methods. So very basic approximate is an LUT method without interpolation, or you get one with interpolation. The best, if you want to get top of the line best fit, is you go fourth or third order polynomials, linear feedback devices. Or you can use the Steinhardt equation, which is really good. And that's where you have the coefficients for all those parts in the equation. And again, like some things like LabVIEW, they'll have those things built in to certain VIs so that you can do those conversions relatively easily and you don't have to reinvent the wheel with everything. Another type of temperature sensor is the PNN junction temperature sensors. These are great for onboard temperature measuring, where you're not measuring in like a wet environment and things like that, or you're just trying to figure out what the motherboard temperature is, or you're trying to figure out what a temperature is where there's circuits nearby, because you can plug it directly in and it actually takes the temperature of the chip itself. So an LM34 is a version in Fahrenheit, and LM35 is a version in centigrade, and they've had updated versions since they made these. And you basically give it some power and a ground, and then you measure the output. And there's a relationship. Doesn't require a whole lot of power, and it's pretty precise, and you don't need to have a subtract constant out of it. It's all built into the chip. So that's about as easy as it gets. All right, that's it for temperature sensors. Next up, we'll talk about optical sensors.